Pastor Varun and Pastor Don LaHopperson would like to welcome you to the following message from New Hope International Church, Seattle, Washington. Here is Pastor Lau's dynamic teaching that will change your life with love, hope, and peace in Jesus Christ.
Welcome to the class to learn about reason for our belief. We need to know what we believe, and we can give answer to people when they challenge us intellectually. Why don't we pray and ask the Lord to speak to all of us. Tonight we will look at the question, is Jesus Christ God or the Creator? I believe that this is one of the fundamental questions that make us different from the whole world or from other religions. Because we call ourselves Christians because we believe in Jesus. We are disciples of Jesus Christ. And if we cannot settle down this issue, if we cannot have confidence that Jesus Christ is God and the Master, the King of all kings, the Lord of all lords, we will just come to church for social gathering, or for personal benefit, or for just following a type of religion. In fact, we want to have an intimate relationship with Christ. Matthew chapter 7, verses 21 to 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. So Jesus said, I never knew you. So in other words, the word knew in the Greek language means intimately knowing Jesus. So my prayer as a pastor of the church, of the local church, is that every member or every saint or disciple in the church will have an intimate relationship with Christ Jesus. But before we can have that intimacy with him, knowing him intimately, we need to have faith first that Christ is everything in our life. Christ is the answer. Christ is the living God. He is the resurrected one. He is the Alpha and Omega. He is the first and the last. He is the first man who brought us into salvation and righteousness. Amen. So we need to come to that conclusion in our heart first, that Christ is God. Unfortunately, many so-called Christians go to church and never really have relationship with Christ. Tonight, I want to encourage all of you that if you haven't started that yet, I want to encourage you that you will really begin to have developed relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ on a daily basis. You need to know him, not as a religious leader, not as a good man, not as a busboy that will come and you click your finger to give you something. You need a girlfriend. You say, Jesus, I need a girlfriend. Give me a girlfriend. No, it's not only, he is not your busboy. He is not your servant, but he is your Lord, your God. You are not just following a wise man. You are not following just a great religious leader, but Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. So tonight we're going to go through scriptures, go through some facts and truth to have strong foundation in our faith. Faith in what? Faith in the Son of God, faith in the Messiah, faith in Christ Jesus, the Anointed One. He is the Son of the living God. Amen. And he is your Savior. So the first question we want to ask is, was Jesus a real person in world history. If you study history, you will find out that many historians, even though they were not Christians, they talk about Jesus. The world historian, like Cornelius Tacitus, a Roman historian who lived during the 50 AD, wrote about the death of Jesus Christ and disciples or Christians in Rome. So even the Roman historian talk about Jesus. Lucian ridiculed the Lord Jesus Christ. He said that Jesus Christ was crucified in Palestine because he had brought a new religion into the world. So this historian talk about the death of Jesus. He is a real person in history. He's not just a fairy tale story. He's a real person. He's not Romeo and Julius. You know, Julian. He is not just a story of a novel book, but he is a real person. Flavius Josephus, a Jewish historian, talked about Jesus too, that he performed miracle. He was arrested and he was crucified on the cross. So many historians talk about Jesus. Amen. So I want to confirm again, if you go and read the historian book of that time, you will find out that Jesus was a real person in the history. It's not just a man-made novel or a fairy tale story. Now, did Jesus Christ claim that he was God? This is a good question. Jesus Christ definitely directly stated that or claimed that he was God. And I want to read scripture to you here. He called himself the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One. You understand the word Christ mean? Christ is in the Greek language. Messiah is in the Hebrew language. It means the anointed one of God. Mean the Son of God that God sent to save the world. He called himself Christ, the anointed one. In Mark chapter 14, verses 61 to 64, but Jesus remained silent and gave no answer. Again, the high priest asked him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?" Jesus said, "I am. And you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One coming on the clouds of heaven." The high priest tore his clothes. "Why do we need any more witnesses?" he asked. "You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" They all condemned him as worthy of death. So you can see that the high priest accused Jesus as claiming to be God, claiming to be the Son of the living God. Jesus definitely claimed to be the Messiah, the Son of the living God. He claimed that he is equal to God. In John chapter 5, verses 17 to 18, Jesus said to them, "My Father is always at his work to this very day, and I too am working. For this reason, the Jews try all the harder to kill him. Not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God." Throughout the 3 years of ministry, Jesus claimed that he was equal to God. And that's why all the Jews were mad at him. They wanted to get rid of him because he claimed to be God himself. In John chapter 10, verses 30 to 33, "I and the Father are one." Can you say that? Can you say that you and the Father are the same? You are one with God. I don't think anyone in this room can say like that. He said that "I and the Father are one." In the Bible, he called his name, "I am," all the time. Do you know that when Moses met God at Mount Sinai, he said, "Who are you?" And God called himself, "I am who I am." So the name of God is I am. Is that right? So Jesus called himself I am. Exodus chapter 3 verse 14. God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelite. I am has sent me to you. And look at what Jesus called himself in John chapter 9 verse 5. Why I am in the world, I am the light of the world. John chapter 10 verse 7 say, Jesus said again, I tell you the truth. I am. Everyone say, I am. Jesus called himself, I am the gate for the sheep. So he called himself, I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You see, he called, I am, I am, I am. So he quoted that he is equal to God. He also said that when somebody knows him, he also knows God. In John chapter 8 verse 19, in Amplified Bible, then they said to him, where is this father of yours? Jesus answered, you know my father as little as you know me. If you knew me, you would know my father. So in other words, he claimed that he is equal to God. Can you say the same sentence? If you know me, you know God. No, I cannot say that. I'm still far away from the perfection of God. But Jesus said, if you knew me, you will know God. It's pretty clear that he claimed that he is God. Is that right? Not only that, he said that if anybody trusts him, they also trust God. In John chapter 14, verse 1, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in me and adhere to and trust in and rely on God. Believe in and adhere and trust in and rely also on me. So he claimed that to trust God is equal to trust him. So in other words, he said, I am God. That's what he tried to say. And not only that, you know that God, Jesus was born into the Jewish culture. And in Jewish culture, according to the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, there is only one God. And you can only worship God. You cannot worship anything else. You remember in Exodus, the Bible, God gave the Ten Commandments to the Jews that you can only worship God, don't worship anything else. Is that right? So if you receive worship from somebody, you claim yourself equal to God. And in the Bible, Jesus received worship from people. Jesus never, you know, I went to Thailand this time, and I mentioned on Sunday that a young lady was delivered from demons. I cast demon out of her in the name of Jesus. And right after she became set free, her eyes became bright. Her face was beautiful. She was so changed right away. And she came to me, you know, in the Thai culture, you know, when you want to show so much appreciation to somebody, they will go down like this and do like this to that person. You know, she still have that kind of culture. She came to my feet and tried to do that to me. And I went down right away and said, no, don't worship me. Don't salute me. Don't do this to me. And I say, do to God. I'm not God. Jesus cast demon out of you, not me. Because I come in the name of Jesus. So I did not accept worship because I'm not God. But look at Jesus' life. All 3 years of his ministry, he never denied any worship from human beings. Amen. Matthew chapter 8 verse 2. And behold, a leper came up to him, prostrating himself, worshipped him, saying, Lord, if you are willing, you are able to cleanse me by curing me. Did Jesus say no? No, Jesus did not say no. Jesus said, you will get what you ask for. So Jesus did not deny people worship him. Amen. So you can see clearly here from scripture that Jesus directly claimed to be God. Jesus directly say, I am God. I am equal to the Father. Now look at the indirect statement that Jesus made. For example, in Mark chapter 2 verse 5, You know the only person that can forgive man's sin is God. I cannot forgive man's sins because I'm not God. I can forgive you, but I cannot forgive all of your sins. I can forgive your sin that you sin against me, but I cannot forgive all of your sin. But look at what Jesus say here in Mark chapter 2 verse 5. And when Jesus saw their faith, their confidence in God through him, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven and put away penalty is penalty is remitted. The sense of guilt removed and you are made upright and in right standing with God." So you can see that Jesus claimed that he forgave the man, that man's sin. So indirectly he tried to say, "I am God, I am the Messiah, I am the God of the universe." Look at John chapter 14 verse 6. Jesus answered, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Do you notice one thing? If you tell people around you that you believe in God, people are not mad at you. You notice that? You say, "Oh, yeah, I believe in God," because there are many gods out there. But if once you say, "I believe in Jesus Christ of Nazareth," oh, I tell you, people don't like it. You know why? Because of this statement. Because this statement really offended a lot of religions and a lot of gods. Because he say, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can come to the Father except through me." Wow. What a statement. He claimed that he is the only way back to heaven. Amen. Now, let's analyze Jesus' claims now together. Okay, everyone agree that Jesus claimed to be God. Everyone agree with that? Amen. Now, according to Jesus' understanding, because he is a Jew, he understand that there is only one God who created the heavens, the earth, and all things. That is his mindset, that there is only one God. And Jesus claimed to be God. So as Jesus claimed to be God, there are only two possibilities. Number one, his claim is correct. And number two, his claim is false or incorrect. So if his claim is true, he is God. Everyone agree with that? Now, if his claim is not true, there are two possibilities. The first possibility is that he knew that he lied. Is that right? He knew that he lied. The second possibility is that he did not realize that his claim was wrong. He truly believed that he is God, but he is not God. You understand? The second two possibility. He knew that he lied. Or the second one, he did not know that he lied, and he believed he is God even though he is not God. So, let's look at this together. If he knew that his claim was not correct, it means that, and he intentionally tried to tell people that he was God. So that means that he is a great liar in the whole world. He is a great liar. He lied to the whole world that he is God. So that is one, the one option. The first option, he is true God. True, he is a great liar. Or if he misunderstood that he is God. In fact, he is not God. What kind of people claim to be God and they are not God? You can find those people at Harborview Hospital and Fairfax. You know what I mean? And some psychiatrist's office. They are in the psychiatrist's office. People who are lunatic or people who are crazy or psychotic. People who don't have a full mind. They are crazy. They are out of mind. People who are crazy that need to see a psychiatrist or need to have demon cast out of them. So we can make a conclusion that number one, Jesus is God. Number 2 Jesus is a liar and number 3 Jesus is psychotic. How many people understand the word psychotic mean? It's a medical word. Psychotic mean people who is out of mind. I give you example. One of the psychotic disease is schizophrenia. Schizophrenia, people who have schizophrenia will have hallucination. They see things and they think that people want to kill them. They are very they don't have the real perception of themselves and of people around them. They look weird. They act weird. Schizophrenia. So these are people who have different kind of psychotic depression. And I know that some of you never meet these people because you are not working in the medical field. But if you work in the medical field, you will find one. Maybe some of you say, I find one at my house, but I don't see that in your house, in the church right now. Okay. So, now, we should not accept him as a religious leader at all, looking at all these three. Some people claim that, oh, Jesus is like Muhammad. He's just a good prophet. He's just a good religious teacher. He's just a good religious leader. Think about it. There are only three possibilities. Either God, lunatic, or a liar, or a psychotic man. There's no way that a psychotic man gonna become a good religious leader. There's no way that a great liar gonna become a good religious leader. So you cut out the possibility that Jesus Christ is a good religious leader. Period. How many people agree with that? So we don't have to talk about that. Jesus Christ is not a good religious leader because he can be only three possibility. Okay. Did Jesus lie that he was God? Let's look at the first one. Is he a liar? Is he a liar? Okay. If he lied, he must be a great liar. He must be a great hypocrite. Because why? Because while he was walking on earth, if you read the four gospels, he taught people to be faithful. He taught people to live a holy life. He taught people to love the needy, help the poor. He taught people to repent of their sin. So how can it's so contradictory here that a liar who committed great sin of lie tell people to do the right thing? So it's kind of contradictory here in his own life. Is that right? So, not only that, if he is a liar, he must be the most stupid person in the whole world. If he's a liar. Why he is the most stupid person in the whole world? Because he was willing to die for his own lying information. Who gonna die for your own lying information? I mean, if the Roman soldier arrests me because I claim to be God and they're gonna nail me on the cross, with a big nail through my median nerve here and through my tarsal nerve in my leg, and not only that, put the thorn, the crown of thorn on my head, I would say, I'm sorry. I lied. Please release me. I'm sorry I lied, you know. Don't nail me on the cross. So is this a stupid thing to lie and die on the cross? Amen? No one gonna be willing to die for their lie. Amen. No one would die for their liar. They will change right away. They will say no. Is that right? Not only that. If I never, you know, I never claim to be perfect in this church. And I can guarantee, if you move into my house, think about it. If you move into my house and stay with Pastor Da and I for only 1 week, you will detect my imperfection. You will detect that I have some weaknesses in my life. That's why I don't want people to stay in my house too long. No, I'm kidding. But you're going to find it. You know, Pastor Dan know very well my weaknesses. The same thing, this disciple walked with Jesus for 3 years. You think they would detect some character flaw or some weaknesses in his life? That they knew that he is not God? You think they would detect that he was not God and he is a liar? Oh, I tell you, you don't need to wait for 3 years. In only a few months, they will find out that he is not God. And you, do you know that how these apostles and disciples died? Did they die for, you know, fighting in the battle for the war of the country, for their nationality? No, they died for what? For the name of Jesus. They were eaten by lions. They were dragged by horses. The head were cut off. Some of them were burned. Some of them were stoned to death, like Stephen, you know. So these people died for somebody. And these people walked with Jesus for 3 years. If Jesus lied, they would know. They would have known. And they would not have died for him. But this disciple knew with their own eyewitnesses and their own experiences that Jesus Christ was not a liar. Therefore, they were willing to die for Jesus. Peter died by being hanged on the cross and with head upside down. You know that? Some people die by spear. Paul, I think his head was cut off. He died for Jesus. A lot of people died for Jesus. So after we look at all this reason, we know right away that Jesus Christ was not a liar. Now look at the second one. Was Jesus psychotic or out of mind? Or, you know, crazy people in the hospital? If Jesus thought that he was a true God, even though he was not, he must have been a crazy or psychotic man. Okay? In other words, he is insane. But if you look at Jesus Christ, if you read the four gospels carefully, and you read the way he talked, the way he ministered, the way he did things, you can see that Jesus was very patient. He was very self-controlled. He understood the significance of his ministry. He knew what he was doing. Large crowds witnessed what he was doing. These people, let me ask you this question. Are you going to go to the mental hospital? And you think thousands of people going to go to the mental hospital to follow a man out there? Will you? Will you drive with the gas price right now to Walla Walla? I think Walla Walla has a mental hospital. What is the name of that hospital? Yeah, okay. That name. Okay, Washington State, something. Will you drive to Walla Walla and meet a crazy man and go down to your knee and say, could you please heal me? Could you please heal my blindness? Could you please heal my leprosy? You think the people would do that? You need to understand that thousands of people were following Jesus Christ. They witnessed. They came to him for help. And not only that, if you listen to his teaching and his word, his teaching and his words were full of authority, were full of wisdom. When he answered questions, for example, should we give taxes to Caesar or not? I believe that if some of us got that question, we might have been, you know, shocked and don't know what to say. Because if you say, yes, give to Caesar, then the Jews will hate you. But if you say, don't give to Caesar, the Roman government gonna arrest you to go to jail. So it's a difficult question for him. But he answered very wisely. You notice that Jesus, the way he spoke, the words he said were full of authority and wisdom and revelation and power. And not only that, he performed so many miracles. You know, the Bible says in the book of John that the book in the whole world even cannot contain what Jesus did in his 3 years of ministry. I believe that so many thousands of people get healed, so many demons cast out, so many miracles. I mean, what record in the four gospels is just a little bit that we can read. So you can see that this is not a psychotic man. So the only answer left the only answer left is this: Jesus Christ was the true and living God. He was not a liar. He was not a psychotic. He was truly God as he claimed. Amen. Are you convinced now? Amen. That Jesus Christ is God. God never lies. Amen. And because God never lies, when he say, I am the way, the truth, and I'm the life, the way, the truth, and the life, there's no one can come to the Father except through me. Can we trust that? Can we trust his teaching? Can we trust what he says? Can we trust his word and his promise? We can trust his promise. We can trust what he say because God never lies. Therefore, we should accept Christ into our life, not just as a good religious man, not just a good religious, good teacher, but he is our God. Amen. Look at his life. His birth was unique. I mean, just look around the circumstances of his life. You can see already that Jesus Christ was the Son of God or was God. His birth was unique. How was he born? From a virgin. He was born from a virgin. Her name is Mary. Is that right? He was born without a man, without the conception. So he did not have the sinful nature like us. He was born by the power of the Holy Spirit. And then he grew up with wisdom and stature. He grew up with wisdom of God. So you can see that his birth and his childhood were very, very unique. Different from you and me. I remember when I was a young child, I was spanked by teacher many times. I steal, I lied, I talk bad, you know, I did so many bad things. But you cannot find evidence. Not only that, think about this. Who knew Jesus the best at that time, in that generation? I believe that Mary knew Jesus the best. Mary gave birth to him. Mary raised him up, saw his action from he was a toddler, growing up to be teenager and become a grown-up man, 30 years old. Mary knew about his development or his growth, his growing up. So if Mary knew in her heart that this baby came from conception, relationship between her and her husband Joseph. In other words, the Bible lied that Jesus was born out from a virgin. At the time they arrested Jesus to go to the cross, I believe that as a mother, she would go to the high priest or to the people of authority and say, stop, stop, stop. This man is not the Son of God. I have relationship with Joseph. This is just a normal man. Let him go. He's crazy. But did Mary do that? Mary was standing there watching Jesus crucified on the cross, and she did not open her mouth and say, this is not God. She knew from her experiences that Jesus Christ was the Son of the living God. The Bible says that not only his birth was unique. The Bible says that he never sinned. He never sinned. And even the Bible says that his enemy cannot even claim that he sinned, except they thought that he blasphemed God. No one can find fault with Jesus. I have to admit that one of the reasons I became a Christian, because when I read the four gospel, I found that Jesus never make any mistake in his life. He is so perfect. He was without sin. Another unique thing about his life, not only he was born from a virgin, not only that he never sinned. Number three, the uniqueness of his life that we have confidence that he was God is that he could perform miracles. He performed so many miracles. And I tell you one thing. One of the unique miracles that no one in the Old Testament did before he was born is casting out demons. Do you know that there is no casting out demons in the Old Testament? Jesus was the only man that cast out demons. And Jesus performed miracle that more than any other people can do. You know, he raised people from the dead, he stopped the wind, he walked on the water, you know, all this stuff. So it's clear that he was not just a normal, typical human being like you and me. Not only that, another uniqueness of Jesus Christ, our Lord, is that his teaching had the greatest and long-lasting influence and impact to the whole world until even today. The teaching of other religious leaders do not have such impact to the whole world. But his teaching impact you and me, impact people of every nationality, every background, Japanese, Chinese, Americans, Laotian, Filipinos, you know, European, any kind, any background can be impacted by the teaching of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And not only that, today, when you believe in Jesus, you can still see miracles and his provision even to today. So in other words, he's still working today through his Spirit. Amen. Jesus has still working in the church today by his Spirit. So his life is so unique. He was raised from the dead on the third day. According to the medical knowledge, after the third day, you would be what? Decay. Have smell. After the third day. But Jesus Christ was resurrected from the dead on the third day, and he was walking on earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and more than 500 people saw him and touched him at that time. What a uniqueness of his life that no other man in the whole world can imitate him. Amen. So come to this point, any question? Are you convinced that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God? Amen. Now, I'm going to go on a little bit more and maybe give us a short break for dinner. How many people haven't had dinner yet? Wow. Should we have a break or should we just go on? Let's go on. Okay. Let's go on until we're done, and then we can have dinner and wrap up. Amen. Okay. Now, one of the... because I am a scientist, I am a scientific person. So I like to look at the evidences in the Bible. And there is one thing in the Bible that really, really impact me and help me to believe in Jesus as the Son of God to today is the issue of prophecies. The Bible contains many thousands of prophecies talking about the future. What's going to happen? Prophecy relate regarding cities, town, governments, regarding a person, a king, you know, regarding world government, regarding even business, the card, Visa, MasterCard was prophesied in the Bible. You know, all this thing is in the Bible. Talk about end time prophecy. But there are also prophecies about the first coming of Jesus Christ. There are altogether more than 300 prophecies regarding the first coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And even Jesus himself talked about those prophecies and quote the scripture. All these 300 prophecies, he talked about it. He said, I come to fulfill the prophecy in the Bible. Why God has to do this? Why God has to give this 300 plus prophecy in the Bible? You know why? How many people knows? to make sure that all of us today who never met Jesus, who never see Jesus with our own eyes, can have confidence that He is the Messiah. Amen. He is the Christ, the Son of the living God. We don't need to have doubt. We don't need to be wavered by any reason or any argument of any man. Even the devil can and whisper to you, oh, you're stupid, you're crazy that you believe in Jesus. You say, no, I'm not stupid, I'm not crazy, I believe in the Son of the living God. It's sure for sure 100%. 300 prophecy plus. Amen. It's almost like this. How to identify Dr. Lau Haprasit? How do we know where Dr. Lau Haprasit live? How do you know? You get the address. Is that right? So starting from what? USA. This doctor live in USA. Second, what city? Bellevue. Third, what street? Southeast 2nd Street. Fourth, what address? What home number? 13840. So you track down the man by looking at the home number, street, city, address, country, and the 98005, the zip code. Is that a zip code? So you track down a man by using a few informations. Is that right? Not only that, they may ask, what is your social security number? 523-68-7654. No, this is a makeup one. Don't worry. This is not a real one. So they track you down. A lot of people, you give social security number. No, this is a fakey one. You track down by looking at the social security number. Is that right? Phone number. Birth date. When I dictate, today I dictate a history and physical exam of a patient to the hospital. When I dictate, I say name, and then I will say birth date and home phone number. You know why? Because there are so many John Nelson in America. So we say, oh, this is a history of physical examination of Mr. John Nelson. The type is with John Nelson, because in the hospital computer list, John Nelson everywhere. So how do you know which John Nelson? You look at the birth date. Bam, you get it. So the same thing. How do you know that Jesus Christ is the Messiah? How do you know that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God? God, instead of giving only five informations, city, country, street, and home number, and social security number, He gave us 300 plus informations. So we know this is exact. This is sure that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. This is not just your own imagination or your own hypothesis. It's real. Amen. So we're going to look at some of this information together. You need to understand one thing, that the Old Testament was written about 450 to 1500 years before Jesus Christ was born. Those writers never met Jesus. It was written many hundred years, 1500 years before Jesus was born. So it's not a coincidence. Now, number two, the Bible that they used in the time of Jesus Christ, they call Septuagint. How many people know Septuagint mean? Septuagint is a Greek translation of the Hebrew version of the Old Testament. And Septuagint was produced about 250 BC, 250 years before Christ was born. So whatever prophecy in the Old Testament was not a retrospective writing. You know what I mean? Like, oh, Jesus was born, then people come back and write Old Testament to match with His life. It's not a retrospective writing, but it's prospective. It was written 250. It was translated into Greek language that they were using in the time of Roman Empire, 250 years before that. Now we're gonna look at some prophecy here just to decorate our brain to know that it's real. This is not our own imagination. The first thing you need to understand that the prophecies about the life of Jesus Christ were very detailed and very exact. No mistake. Whatever prophesies in the Old Testament, very detailed, and happened to him exactly the same. No missing. You know, I remember when I was a young man, before I became a Christian, I love to go to fortune teller. I look at the star, you know, astrology. What happened to my life? I like to ask this question all the time. What kind of woman I gonna marry to? I know that some young men like to ask this question. Oh, what kind of woman I gonna marry to? And my dad say, oh, you're gonna have many wives. He said that. But it's wrong. I have only one wife. So fortune teller can make mistake. Is that right? The prophecy that come from Satan can be wrong. But the prophecy in the Bible, Pastor Da said, thank God that prophecy is wrong. That fortune teller is wrong. Amen. So, you know, but the prophecy in the Bible is exactly fulfilled. No mistake at all. I give you example. Jesus was born from the tribe of Judah. Genesis chapter 49 verse 10 say, the scepter of leadership shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet. And what happened to Jesus? In Luke chapter 3, the Bible says, now Jesus himself was about 30 years old when he began his ministry. He was a son. So it was true of Joseph, the son of Heli. And then verse 33, the son of Aminadab, the son of Ram, the son of Hezron, the son of Perez, the son of Judah. Jesus came from the tribe of Judah. Is it interesting? He did not even come from the tribe of Joseph or other tribes. God specifically chose Judah to be the ancestor of the Lord Jesus Christ, according to the prophecy. Not only that, not only great-great-grandfather of Jesus, the Bible also prophesies that exactly that it will come from the family of Jesse. Isaiah chapter 11 verse 1, 700 years before Jesus Christ was born, there shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. Verse 10 say, and in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, who shall stand as a banner to the people, for the Gentiles shall seek him, and his resting place shall be glorious. Talking about who? The Messiah. So did Jesus come from the family of Jesse? Yes. Luke chapter 3 verse 32 say, the son of Jesse, the son of Obed, the son of Boaz, the son of Salmon, and the son of Nahshon. He came from Jesse. Is it amazing? Wow. The prophecy was given 700 years, specifically about which family he's going to come from. Not only that, the son of David. The Bible prophesies that Jesus Christ will come out of David, King David. Jeremiah chapter 23 verse 5, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will raise up to David a righteous branch, sprout, and he will reign as king, capital king, and do wisely and will execute justice and righteousness in the land. Did Jesus come from King David, branch of King David? Yes. In Mark chapter 10, verses 47, 48 say, and when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David. Wow. Judah, Jesse, David, tracked down like an address. You know, 13840 Southeast 2nd Street. Okay, Bellevue, Washington 98005. Track down that this is the man that we talk about here, the Messiah. Amen. The Bible also talk about he would be anointed by the Holy Spirit in Isaiah chapter 11 verse 2, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the reverential and obedient fear of the Lord. And what happened to him when he came out from the Jordan River? The Spirit of God came upon him. You remember the story in Matthew chapter 3. He was anointed by the Spirit without limit. Amen. I want to encourage you that lately I come to the point of my life now. I just was talking to God in my office a while ago and driving here. I say that, God, I came to the point of my life to realize this, that I cannot do anything without your anointing, without your Holy Spirit. Pastor Lau, without the anointing of the Holy Spirit, is just a mere man. I cannot produce any fruit of righteousness. I need the anointing like Jesus Christ. If Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, needs the whole measure, the fullness of the anointing, we, not even God, we were born from the flesh, not from the Holy Spirit. How much more we need the anointing of the Spirit of God. Amen. I come to this part of my life now. You know, when I was standing on the pulpit in Bangkok, and I was preaching the word of God and ministering, laying on a hand on people, I never thought even one bit that this is Pastor Lau laying on of hand and preaching the gospel. I was standing there and say, the Spirit of Jesus Christ, could you work through me? I'm just a vessel. I'm nothing. You are everything. You need to come to that point of your life that you say, God, I'm nothing. Without you, I cannot do anything. Amen. If Jesus did that, we need that too. If Jesus need the Spirit without limit in John chapter 3 verse 34, for one whom God has sent speak the word of God, for God gives the Spirit without limit. So I want to encourage all of you to seek to have more and more and more higher level of anointing. God can increase in you. Amen. God can give you the increase. You remember the parable of the servant, that the servant put the talent in the ground and God pull it, take it and give it to the servant who keep using the talent. So in other words, according to the scripture, the anointing and the Spirit of God can increase in your life, the level of anointing. So we need to serve God faithfully. We need to love Jesus. We need to be close to Jesus. We need to be hungry for the Spirit of God. And we need to humble ourselves, to die to ourselves, and seek the Spirit of God. Amen. I can see already from the testimony of this young lady, 32 years old doctor in Phuket, that she came up to Bangkok and sought the Spirit of God. And when she went back home, miracle began to happen because she was so hungry. You know, I just called her yesterday because she has something to consult with me, called to Phuket. And she said that, I'm asking her, what are you doing right now? Do I bother you? Are you sleeping? No. And this is 1 a.m. over there. No. What are you doing? I am listening to your CD and studying the Word of God. I am hungry. I want to know how to cast out demons. I want to have more Holy Spirit in me. I'm so hungry for the Word of God. Who, when I listen to that in the telephone, I'm like, yes, Phuket is going to be shaken by the power of God. Amen. Because this lady is so hungry for the Word of God. She listened to she emailed Pastor Noom and say, send every lesson that you have that Pastor Lau sent to you to me right now. Send a package of every CD to me. I'm going to listen to every CD. I want to learn the Word of God. You see, you need to be hungry. You need to want more. We want to, you know, hungry like the Lord Jesus Christ. He went out to You know, Jesus Christ cannot do the ministry without the Holy Spirit. He did everything by the anointing, by the Spirit of God. Amen. I'm going to stir you up a little bit here because we are talking intellectual for a long time now. I want to challenge you. Hallelujah. The Bible talk about God sent a messenger before Jesus was born. In Isaiah chapter 40 verse 3, another prophecy. A voice of one who cries, prepare in the wilderness the way of the Lord. Clear away the obstacle. Make straight and smooth in the desert a highway for our God. And what happened? God sent John the Baptist. In Matthew chapter 3, talking about John, the Baptist went out to prepare the way for Jesus and say, repent, and then the kingdom of God will come to you. So in other words, John the Baptist go and prepare the way. You know, I want to encourage you something. Sometime God use you and me. Right now, as a church, God is using all of us to prepare this for the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know what I mean? We have the job as John the Baptist in the sense. We have the ministry of John the Baptist that we prepare the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And at the same time, you and me are being used to prepare. There's something greater than us in the future. I want to encourage you. Today I share with one of my patients. When I was sharing, I was crying. I mean, we all cry, actually. This patient come from Moses Lake. They are Christian. I say like this. They say to me that, how you become a Christian? I say, I was a Buddhist, and then I went to Canterbury, and a missionary couple went to Canterbury named Dan and Fan Cobb. The church was struggling, having only 20, 30 people. Never grow. The church never grew. But this couple spent time a lot with me and Da, my wife. For 3 years, pour out their life, taught me Bible, came to my house every week, spent time with me, disciple me, taught me how to be a good preacher. And they are Baptists, by the way. They are Southern Baptists. So I want to give glory to Southern Baptist denomination. And they left Thailand, and nothing happened that much in that church. Only 20, 30, actually after they left, the church even collapsed, shrink in numbers. The number of the church went down, less and less people, because a missionary gone. But God remind me when I share that with my patient that, you know, that couple, the whole point of God sent them to Canterbury is for you. And now you plant a church in America, start a church in Bangkok, in Nakhon Pathom, now in Phuket, and now going to spread all the world. And I want to give credit to this couple. Without this couple, you will not be here. So sometimes God may use you. You may not be a great preacher, that preaching to somebody, you know, you may not have a 30,000 member church like some pastor in America. But if you are faithful, discipling somebody as a man or a woman that prepared the way for the future, who knows, one of the youth group member, you may not have a big youth group. You may have only 20, 30 youth in your group, but you are faithful. Maybe one of the youth group can go and become a pastor or apostle that shake Japan. Don't look down on the small thing you are doing for God, because God is preparing somebody through you, like John the Baptist is preparing the way for Jesus. Therefore, I want to encourage all of you that please make disciples. Please pick up a sheep in the church. Disciple them. Don't give up on them. Amen. If that missionary couple give up on me because they don't see my fruit right away, they didn't see it because I was still goofy, you know, kind of not very good. Pastor Da, kind of, at that time, was not very on fire because we were not in revival. But because we want to go visit them in March, we're going to buy a ticket to go to Georgetown, Kentucky, to visit them. Because they have impact on our life so much. They are 80-something years old now. You see, I want to show love to people who really have impact on my life. Amen? So, you know, brother and sister, be faithful in discipling people. Be faithful in reaching out to somebody. Now, some of you have been in our church long enough. Now, I'm sorry, I'm going to start to preach now. Some of you are in our church long enough. You know, for example, like William and Tracy, you can rise up. You've been Christian for a year now. You can say, I'm going to pick up some younger believer in the church. Pastor, use me. Care group leader, use me. I'm going to disciple them. I'm going to teach them. You teach me, I'm going to teach somebody else. You spend time with me, I'm going to spend time with somebody else. You know what? Maybe you are teaching somebody that's going to go and check Mexico. You can teach somebody who's going to go and plant big church in Los Angeles. You are faithful in doing what God called you to do. Amen. Like John the Baptist, actually he was beheaded. His head was cut off, but he was faithful to prepare the way for the Messiah. Be faithful. Don't give up. Amen. God is using you for the bigger thing in the future. Don't look at today. God is using faithful people. Amen. Now, the Bible also prophesies that he would begin his ministry in Galilee. Isaiah chapter 9 verse 1 talking about he will begin the ministry in Galilee. And what happened in Matthew chapter 4 say, now when Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he departed to Galilee and leaving Nazareth, he came and dwelt in Capernaum, which is by the sea in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali. Now from that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So you can see that the prophecy in the book of Isaiah became fulfilled, that he started his ministry not in Nazareth, not in his hometown, but in Galilee. I remember a few weeks ago, I was watching PJ preaching to the youth group. And you know what God spoke to me? Don't treat one another in this church like a prophet in his own hometown. In other words, I see PJ come in this church from the first day that she was a young believer. And I keep looking at her as a young believer. And she will never rise up to the top where God wants her to be. In the same thing here, we need to treat each other with faith. When I see Yumi, I see many churches in her. The seed is in her. I cannot just see her, oh, a young girl. She cannot do much. She speaks broken English. Oh, you know, she will not. She's just a young girl in the church. No, 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 no. If we look at her like that, we are doing the same thing with people in Nazareth to Jesus because they get used to him. Amen. We need to look at Yumi as an anointed woman. And when she sings song, the anointing will come out of her. We need to honor each other. My dear brother and sister, don't look down on each other in the church. Trust God that God can work in our brother and sister's life. Amen. Don't treat each other like a prophet in his own hometown. Amen. Now, the Bible also prophesies that Jesus Christ would perform miracles. Isaiah 35 verses 5 to 6 say, then will the eyes of the blind be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer, the mute tongue shout for joy, water will gush forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert. Talking about the work of the Messiah. And what happened? Did Jesus perform miracle, open people's ears? Did Jesus open people's eyes, the blind eyes open? Yes, the prophecy became fulfilled. And I want to encourage you one thing to build your faith right now. What can I say something to you? Jesus said like this in the book of John chapter 14 verse 12. The work that I do, you shall do also. And greater works than this you shall do, because I will go to my Father. So in other words, you should expect to work miracles. If Jesus performed miracle, you can perform miracle. But it's about your faith. Since past evangelist Mike Francine came last time, I tell you, my faith rise up. I hang around with him for a couple of days. Whew, I believe that if I'm going to minister in miracles like him, cast out demon, healing the sick. Blind eye can see. Amen. So God can use Kun Chai Chan to perform miracle one day. You need to build your faith. South Seattle is going to be shaken. Amen. By the power of God there. Don't be scared. Amen. So, you know, you need to believe that God, if God can use Jesus, God can use you too. It's the level of faith. Today, somebody emailed me and asked me, can I cast out demon for myself? Or should I wait for a godly man to come and lay hand on me? You know what I email back? I say like this. If you have faith that you can cast demon out of yourself, do it. If you don't have that faith, wait. Because it's the level of faith. It's about faith. Amen. Jesus walked by faith. The Bible talks about prophecy that Jesus would teach in parables. Psalm chapter 7 to 8 verse 2. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark saying of old. And it's true. In Matthew chapter 13 verse 34, these things all taken together, Jesus said to the crowd in parables. The prophecy became fulfilled. I can go on and on all night about the prophecy. Maybe I give a few examples. Amen. I give a few examples. I cannot quote everything in here because it's going to go on all night. So many prophecy. Look at another prophecy that he would be raised from the dead. It's in Psalm chapter 16 verse 10. For you will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your holy ones to see corruption. Talking about resurrection. And what happened? Jesus was resurrected according to the prophecy in the book of Psalm chapter 16. You see, prophecy became fulfilled one by one here. Look at another prophecy. He would be sold for 30 silver coins. Specific, the number 30. Can you imagine? The prophecy for the life of Jesus Christ are so exact and detailed. Zechariah chapter 11 verse 12, and I said to them, if it seem just and right to you, give me my wages, but if not, withhold them. So they wait out for my price, 30 pieces of silver. And what happened? Judas sold Jesus for 30 silver coins. Matthew 26 verse 15, and said, what are you willing to give me if I hand him over to you? And they went out for and paid to him 30 pieces of silver. Exact number. The Bible is an amazing book, huh? If you study the Bible and you don't believe in Jesus, I don't know what to do. I think you need a brain transplant. If you study the Bible and you say you don't believe in Jesus, either you don't have brain or you have brain but you just have a hardened heart. If you just use your brain to look at this, you know that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. He is the Son of the living God. No question at all. So detailed and so many prophecy. The Bible says that the silver coin will be thrown into the temple of God. Zechariah chapter 11 verse 13. And the Lord said to me, cast it to the potter, the munificently, some at which I am priced by them, and silver cast them to the potter in the house of the Lord. Matthew 27 verse 5, and casting the pieces of silver into the holy place of sanctuary of the temple, he departed and he went off and hanged himself. So not only silver coin, but he threw the silver coin into the temple. Wow, the prophecy became true. Amen. Look at another prophecy. Jesus would not open his mouth to argue. Isaiah 53 verse 7. He was oppressed. He was afflicted. He was submissive and opened not his mouth. Did he do that? While he was persecuted, while he was arrested, did he open his mouth and try to argue? No. He was quiet. He answered only a few questions. That's it. He did not yell from the cross, D-A-M-Y-U-O-U, or you know, he didn't use bad word, he didn't argue, he didn't say anything bad. He just was quiet. Amen? Should we do the same thing? When people talk bad about us, when people persecute us, we should be quiet like Jesus. Amen? So I can go on all night about all this prophecy. Actually, I have so many pages here. I'm going to skip here. Now, people may say like this. Oh, all this prophecy. Maybe Jewish people, they maybe happened by accident. Maybe just Jesus happened to be born from the tribe of Judah. Maybe just accidentally he was born, he was sold with 30 silver coins. It's all by accident, by chance. People can argue. Okay, I want to explain two things about this, about by chance here. Number one, if you look at the life of Jesus carefully, a lot of things that happened to him are beyond his own manipulation or control. I give you example, the place of his birth, Bethlehem. You think he can control that? That he can control his own, the place of birth? Can you control his your own place of birth? You know, sometimes I kind of complain to Dada. You know, I feel bad that I should have been born as American so that when I preach, I have no accent. So that I have a big church here. So when people listen to my sermon, it will be like very smooth, you know, talk smooth, and people like the way I speak. I have no accent. People listen and, oh yes, I can go into the TV and preach the gospel on the TV as an American pastor, build a big church here. You know what Da say? Mom, he put you to be born in Thailand. That's it. You have no choice. And you have to speak accent in America. You have no choice. This is it. And I have to accept it. It's beyond my manipulation. Amen? So I have to just rejoice in my accent. And people have to bear with me. Amen. Hallelujah. Actually, one of my patients encouraged me. He turned on to internet and listened to our sermon here. And he comes to me and say, oh, I want to encourage you, Pastor Dr. Lau, your accent is not too bad. It's good. It's fun. Better than many American pastors. So I say, thank you. I didn't even ask him to say that. Okay. What else that could not be manipulated by Jesus himself? The time of his birth. Can you manipulate the time of your birth? He was born exactly when Herod was the governor of that city. Is that right? In the time that the Roman Empire was taking over the Jewish community. He cannot manipulate the time of his birth. He could not manipulate how he's going to be betrayed. Is that right? How he's going to die? Can he manipulate that? No way. He cannot born and say, hey, crucify me. No. It happened. And actually, anyway, I want to say this. Crucifixion is the way to kill the criminal that was only used by the Roman Empire the most. After that, you never see any more crucifixion. Nazi, Hitler did not use the cross. Is that right? Terrorists did not use the cross. Only the Roman Empire used the cross to kill the criminal, that prisoner. So this is amazing. One empire and then finish and done and never use again. Only for Jesus. Amen. He cannot control the reaction of people who hated him. He cannot control the place that they bury him. Is that right? All of these things are out of his control. Now, people may still argue that, oh, it's by chance. So one man he is a scientist named Peter Stoner. He published in the magazine called Science Speaks. he calculated mathematically he calculated that if a man fulfill 8 prophecies in his lifetime, in other words, the prophecy was given and then this man was born and fulfill all the 8 prophecy, what is the probabilities, you know, when you toss a coin, what is the probability of being a head and a tail? 50%. Thank you. Good mathematician. Good math. Very good. Okay. 50%. So he calculated that if 8 prophecy were given to a man and all 8 prophecy became fulfilled, what is the probability? It is equal to the odds are at 1 in 10/17 power. 1/100,000,000,017 times. Or in other words, 1 in 100,000,000,000,000. So if you put this amount of $1 coins over the entire state of Texas, it will cover the whole state about 2 feet deep. And out of that, you blindfold somebody and paint one coin into a special color in that amount of coin, and you blindfold and say, pick out one that coin out of that amount, 1 in 100,000,000,000,000 coins. That is the probability of 8 prophecy. How many prophecy Jesus had? 300 plus. You think his life came out, what happened to him was an accident or by chance? No way. Is that right? No way. How many people are convinced now that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God? Amen. If you listen to this CD and now you are convinced that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God, and you realize that you are not perfect, and you commit sin, you have lied, you have cheated, you have had wrong attitudes, I want to encourage you that the Lord Jesus Christ loved you so much, and he came into the world 2,000 years ago. He died on the cross with suffering to pay for the penalty of your sin. And he wants to come into your life to become your personal God. It's very simple and very easy. You just say, God, I turn away from my sin. I want you to forgive me. Could you please come into my life, Jesus? I want to be born again. I want to have a personal relationship with God. You can pray that simple prayer, and then your life will never be the same. He is the way, the life, and the truth that you can go to the Father. I have done that. I have prayed that prayer 25 years ago, and I never regret it. Can I ask you to pray with me, those who listen to this CD right now? Pray with me that you will accept Jesus Christ into your heart. I'm going to lead you in prayer right now. Father in heaven, I admit, Lord, that I am a sinner. I need your forgiveness. I turn away from my sins, and I want to come back to you. I want to have a relationship with you. I believe, Father, that the way to go back to you is through Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Lord Jesus, I confess with my mouth and believe in my heart that you are Lord and Savior. You were raised from the dead on the third day. Lord Jesus, come into my life right now. Sit on the throne of my life And I will walk with you from now on. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Congratulations. I'm so glad that you accept Jesus Christ. Please find a good church. Find a church that teach the Bible, believe in the power of the Holy Spirit, and start to tell people that you have become a Christian. And start serving God. Amen.
We trust this message has ministered to you. If you would like more information about New Hope International Church or other teaching series, please contact us at 206-275-1042 or visit our website online at www.newhopeinternationalchurch.org. You may also write to us at the following address: New Hope International Church, 9170 Southeast 64th Street, Mercer Island, Washington, 98040. Thank you very much.